Good morning, everyone, and we're on our pre-show drive at the moment. But have a look at this. We've got a beautiful sunrise. I think it's going to be a magnificent sunrise this morning. Some lovely color in the sky already. We're just getting started, so the show is yet to begin officially. Hope you're all having a wonderful day so far, wherever you are in the world, or a wonderful evening. I wonder, we might get really lovely view of this sunrise on the next little clearing. I think that could be really good. With the cloud cover, it's always a wonderful sunrise. Helps add to the effect of that beautiful color. Well, we had a wonderful storm last night. That's exciting news that we've got from the course of the evening. A beautiful storm, thunder and lightning, quite a bit of rain, which was lovely. It seems to have cleared up now completely, which is great. So it doesn't affect the game drives. Jandre, how did you, do you sleep better in the rain or not?
Yeah.
I think I do too. It's much cooler, it's much better. Yeah, I think we're going to get a lovely sunrise there. And then we had an exciting afternoon yesterday, or evening rather. We bumped into Karula, who came running out almost right next to us. She was trying to hunt, and then we eventually left her moving through a thicket. This shows you never know what you're going to bump into out here. And Brent is out in the other vehicle this morning with us. Brent and Gert, they will be on the other vehicle. And I think Steph will be on bushwalk this morning a little bit later, once we get a bit more light. Let's just have a look and see. Should get to this clearing soon. Go. Nice clear open area. It's nice to often just stop and listen in the mornings. Not to my brakes, but it's about 24 degrees Celsius or 76 degrees Fahrenheit. So beautiful, cool morning. I would have thought it would have been cooler after the rain, but I think because of the cloud cover, it still insulated some of the warmth. But look at that beautiful burning sky this morning. Lovely color. So we're going to be starting very soon. So we'll see you shortly. And you can just sit and enjoy the sunrise with us.
This program features live coverage of an African safari.
and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
Welcome to South Africa. It was a stormy, tempestuous night with howling winds. Unfortunately, not much rain. Now it's time to find out what's out and about after a long night. This is Safari Live. Welcome to Juma Private Game Reserve here on the edge of the Kruger National Park. We're part of the 8.5 million acre Greater Kruger. I'm way down in the south of our traverse looking for a female come to love dearly. Her name is Karula and she's our dominant female. She's got two cubs presently and we're hoping with that dark stormy night she's managed to make a kill. It's great hunting weather for the big cats. Not so great if you're an impala or a kudu. But the one thing that is not so great for us is even that little bit of rain makes seeing her footprints that much harder. So we're gonna go have a quick look up the southern boundary. When Byron lost her, she was heading south, which sometimes is never a good thing because it means she might be heading towards the edge of our traverse where we've just arrived and she might cross over. I think her cubs, she left them down there, but let's hope she made a kill between where Byron lost her and our southern boundary. So we're just gonna have a little trundle up the boundary, see if we can find any sign of her. And of course this is 100% live, so please send us questions on using the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can send us an email to questions@wildearth.tv. Okay, Queen Karula, where are you? Now, there's still quite a bit of cloud around. It looked like it was breaking up. It's gonna be interesting to see how it pans out in the morning. You can see it's quite dark in the west, but it's quite light in the east and the south. And our rain normally comes from the south and the east. See, it's one of those in-betweens. So I don't know whether it's cold or whether it's warm, but I think I'm gonna put my jacket back on. It's a little bit chilly. There's a wind that's picked up. It's theoretically not that cold, around 24 degrees Celsius, which is in the 70s Fahrenheit. But, all of a sudden there's a chilly wind coming from the west. Are we gonna get rain from the west? That would be quite unusual. So I'm guessing that if Karula's crossed, it's been somewhere between here and Weaver's Nest Road. So while I try scour the ground for tracks of the Queen, let's go say good morning to Byron.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Byron, and on camera with me this morning is Jandre. And I'm not too sure what our plan is going to be for the day. I think why don't some of our viewers give us suggestions, see what we should do, what would you like to see, and then we can perhaps try to do that this morning. I am going to head across to Arethusa though. I'm just doing one or two radio tests on that side, but going to be heading across there. So give us your ideas, what you'd like us to look for, and then it might make it a bit easier for us. Who knows? It's a nice, lovely, cool morning, and that should help us with some animal movements. Possibly still get a lot more movement out of the animals because it is cooler. But I wonder if it stays clear like this, it could become quite warm later on. While Brent is searching for Karula, he was searching yesterday and then she somehow just managed to pop out close to us. And I'm also just scanning for tracks. elephant, yes, finally. I've been looking for elephant for how long? Just gonna see if I can get a nice view. There seems to be a beautiful little baby there too. Hold on, maybe from this angle. There's one over there, there's a few around. There's a big female to the back, which we can't see just yet. She may come into our frame soon. And she's got a little calf with her. Oh, wonderful. I was saying the whole of yesterday, we haven't seen elephant in for ages, and I've been looking all over for them. So I'm so glad we got, what a nice surprise. Great way to start the morning. This looks like a small herd. I don't see any others around at the moment. I can only count three large elephant and the one little calf. Oh, this little one just seems a little bit upset, possibly because that little calf is here. But that's just a more of a warning. Often you get, and Philip all the way from New York, you're also hoping to see elephant. Well, there we go. Now sometimes these little teenagers, these younger elephant, do try and test us a little bit. They want to see if we're a threat, if we're a danger, and if they're able to chase us away. See that head shake, all little signs that it wants to try and intimidate us and get us to move away. But it's not really aggression as such. And it, as I said, it is a younger elephant, so we generally don't have to worry too much. I'd like to sit here a little bit and see if that calf does decide to come out. Still can't really see it. I get a glimpse every now and then, but we're going to wait here a bit. Lovely to see these elephants though. Windy this morning. The wind's picked up quite a bit. Sometimes it can cause elephants to be a little bit uneasy, purely because they rely on their sense of smell and their hearing, and if it's very, very windy, those senses become a lot harder to use. Oh, I love watching elephants, just the way they feed. They're incredibly intelligent. Ability to use that trunk to pull out tiny little weeds or leaves that they're feeding on, or grass shoots. And then obviously the power that they have to be able to break branches and chew on massive stumps or branches to strip off bark really is incredible. They seem as if they've settled down. That one's not as worried about us anymore. I always say a feeding elephant is a happy elephant. And I think that female with her calf is going to be coming through. There we go, look there. Oh, wonderful. That's a young little one. I wonder, it could possibly be, it's always difficult to really gauge age, but judging by the size, I'd say close to a year old. Rose, newborn elephant are not born blind. They're born precocial, which means they are able to stand up and move around very, very soon after birth. So it wouldn't help if they were blind. They obviously need to get up and move around with the herd for safety reasons. So they're not born blind at all. Just like many of the antelope species, or all the antelope species, the giraffe, buffalo, zebra, all those animals, all the young are born precocial, which means they are able to not quite fend for themselves, but they're able to get up and start moving around with the female, with the mother. Animals that are born altricial, which means completely helpless, would be leopard cubs, lion cubs. They are born into a den, and the females have to look after them for a few months. They are born blind and helpless, just like we basically born altricial, completely helpless. Brakes, sorry. There they go. They seem a little bit restless this morning for some reason. There goes the big female with the calf. Oh, what a lovely, lovely view. Amazing how quickly these elephants can move out of an area when they want to. And there's still one just off to our left, so I just want to keep an eye on it. Don't want to get between it and the rest. It might decide to run across the road. Let's see. Just hiding behind this bush. Let's just wait here. As I said, I don't want to get between it and the other elephant. That can sometimes cause the elephant to be a bit unhappy, maybe feel a bit distressed. But this one seems okay. We'll see when it decides to come out into the open, once it decides to follow the others, which I do think might be fairly soon, because the others are moving off quite quickly. For some reason, that female with the calf is not interested in staying out in the open. She's moving away very, very quickly. The young elephant has some beautiful little tusks already. Mike, you wanted to know if the smaller tusks mean, is it a juvenile? Oh, look at that, running away, trying to catch up to the others now. Mike, not necessarily. Generally speaking, smaller tusks, yes, you would imagine to see on a smaller elephant or younger elephant. But occasionally some elephant, you know, their tusks don't grow out at all. That can happen at times. Look at it running off there. But with a lot of the younger elephant, you do see much smaller, thinner tusks. And then obviously the older they get, they do get a lot larger, longer and thicker. Generally speaking, that is what happens. Occasionally with females, their tusks might not necessarily get as thick as males, but they do get quite long. But like I said, you might find an elephant where the tusks haven't grown out at all. And that can happen and does happen on occasion. No. Look at the rain in the distance. Look at that. Beautiful. Elihu, you want to know how long do the calves stay with the mother? So with elephant, the young female calves, even the young males, they'll stay within that herd. The best way to describe it is when the young males leave a herd, and that's usually around the age of maybe between 15 and 20, somewhere around there, and they'll potentially move off and meet up with the big dominant male. And the reason for that is those big dominant males will help teach those younger males how to be successful, where to look for food, and how to find females. So I just hear something in there. A big dung beetle that I'll have to get out soon. So the rest of the young elephant will stay within the herd. The young females stay within that herd. They just grow the numbers. In terms of when the youngsters suckle from the mothers, some young elephant will continue to try and suckle from a mother anywhere up to 5 years, even a bit longer if they're lucky. They'll still try and get some milk from the mother, but generally the average is between 2 and 4 where they do suckle, and then they'll stop, but they'll stay within that herd and they'll just grow the size of the herd. Beautiful to see that rain in the distance. Ali, you want to know, are there any animals in the Kruger that where the fathers are involved in the upbringing of the offspring? Now let me think. Good question, Ali. I definitely know of some birds, and I'll get to that now. I'm just trying to think of animals first. Certain animals like jackal, we've got side-striped jackal that we do see in this area, and they generally stay in pairs, the male and female, and the female will give birth to the pups, but the male will still be around and probably provide food for them too. So I don't know to what extent he raises the pups. It's mainly the female's role, but they stay in small family groups, a small little pack of jackal, I suppose you could call it. And then wild dogs, I'm trying to think. See, the wild dogs, you have an alpha male and female, but the whole pack looks after the female and her youngsters, so probably not. Warthogs, perhaps, but generally the males do move off on their own after a while. You might get to see a group where a male and a female are together with some youngsters, but I don't think the males really have much to do with the upbringing of offspring. Now, birds, however, one of the best known birds for doing this is the African jacana, and I'll show you a picture of one quickly. And they are very, very interesting birds, the African jacana, and I'll tell you why. It's because the females, let me just find it quickly. Not quite the females, but the males are the ones that that raise the young, not the females. So it's funny, but the females literally mate with the males, lay the eggs, and then the males are the ones that will sit on the nest and incubate the eggs and then raise the chicks. And have a look at that. That's the male, or the African jacana, this beautiful bird over there. And some people refer to them as lily trotters, but they've got the largest feet in proportion to body size than any other bird in Africa. So they spread their weight evenly on reeds so that they're able to walk around the water and on the water. And these birds are always found near water, dams, occasionally rivers, but mainly dams and larger water holes. So this is known as polyandrous, where the males look after the chicks or the young and not the females. And the females may also have more than one male partner, so they may potentially have two or three different male partners that they will mate with, lay the eggs, and then the males will sit on the nest and incubate the chicks and look after the chicks when they hatch. Isn't that interesting? All right, and Aaron, we are heading towards Arethusa, so towards that airstrip area. Perhaps we can have a look for jackal and secretary birds down there. I know you'd like to see them, and who knows? While I head in that direction, let's head back to Brent and see how his leopard tracking is going.
we're still searching for the queen. We didn't find any tracks on the southern boundary, but with the rain, it's quite easily we could have missed one. Hello, Kodul. You seen a leopard this morning? No? You look quite relaxed. Rough night last night, all those strong winds. Lightning, thunder. There you have female kudu. Not looking too stressed. Not like there's a leopard close by. Here comes another one. Now, it looks like the sun's going to win the battle today. Break up the cloud. Just want to listen for a second. Still no signs of alarm calls. No signs of tracks just yet. I'm going to check the treehouse waterhole. Now, Byron lost her going into this area, but after this rain, if she walked here before the rain, the chances of us seeing a track are very slim. Some of the sections of road here are quite hard. Paul. Paul's wondering why we can't cross boundaries. Are those areas off limit to all vehicles or are they owned by different landowners? They are owned by different landowners, and our Travis agreement in this part of the Sabi Sands is only with Juma, Cheetah Plains and Arethusa. So other lodges can drive in those areas. Unfortunately, for now, we can't. Okay, we're approaching the treehouse waterhole. And there's been that not so well looking hippo. He's been here for the last couple of days, but maybe, oh no, he hasn't moved, but let's get up onto the dam wall. He's still here. He would have been hoping for quite a lot more rain, fill up his little pond. So hippos will graze at night and try to return to the water during the day and try to protect themselves from the blistering African sun. Now, he's been in a battle with another hippo bull at some stage, and a battle it looks like he lost. Now the oxpeckers are proving quite the nuisance, keeping some of those wounds open so they can feed off his blood. You can see how pink and raw those wounds are, and that's almost exclusively from the oxpeckers. Now, Julie was wanting to come check up on this hippo. Well, here we are, Julie. Oof, shame, poor guy. Now, the two animals that have taken the biggest knock from the drought has definitely been the hippo and the buffalo. What always amazes me is the terrapins. I mean, they've gone through this drought. They've been hiding and keeping their heart rates low. And as soon as there's this tiny bit of water, if we look in the corner here, there's difficult to say, but 20, 30 little heads popping in and out. There we go. Hello, terrapins. They've actually got quite a nasty bite on them. Now, they don't really have teeth, but their whole jaw is bone, and they've got that very sharp sort of point at that apex of the mouth. And they are capable of quite some nips. Okay, well, bye-bye, Mr. Hippo. Bob and all the terrapins, we've got leopards to find. Morning, Aubrey, just a small climb on Law of Mobile West at Junction Philemon's Dip, Zoe's Road. Copy. I've checked around Treehouse and around the boundary. I'm heading towards Twin Dams. Hi, Amber. Amber's wondering whether a hippo gets sunburned if it was out of the water. It's sort of sunburned. What happens is the skin dries out and becomes quite... what's the word I'm looking for here? Not brittle, but it dries out quite quickly and can crack and be very painful. Now, hippos secrete a pinky, oily substance that also works as a bit of a sunblock, but they are specifically designed not to wander around in the day. Even though they've got incredibly thick skin, it is quite sensitive. Now, still so far no sign of a queen Karula, but we're going to keep checking. We're going to head a little bit further to the east, down towards the Mawati River. Maybe she popped down there. Oh, she could have gone any direction from that block. Now, we've checked to the west and we've checked to the south. We haven't checked to the east and north yet, so that's where we're heading. And you notice we're not seeing nearly as much general game as we used to. Not as much. Oh, there used to be lots of zebra around, lots of waterbuck, and giraffe as well. We had quite a few buffalo. But now with the rain, they've all spread out far and wide, and they would have moved to areas that might have had a little bit better rain than us, and there's nice luscious green grass there for them to feed. Also, a lot of those areas don't have permanent water, but now with rains, those little mud wallows fill up. It gives them an opportunity to spread into other areas and utilize other areas at a different time of the year. Julia. Julia says, is there another name for the European cuckoo we saw yesterday? She can't seem to find it on her bird app. I think in Europe it's called a common cuckoo, Julia. So a common cuckoo, we call it a European cuckoo here because it migrates all the way from Europe to visit us. But I think in Europe it is called a common cuckoo. Oh! What are you still doing out and about? Here we go, little scrub hare. Oh, got a fright from a diker and scattered off. The diker ran, the scrub hare thought, well, there must be something dangerous around like a leopard, I'm out of here. So those are normally nocturnal and spend their evenings out grazing on grass. And you can see those massive ears are one of their best forms of defense against predators. They've also got good eyesight. But one of the interesting things about scrub hares is that they eat their own feces up to 7 times. So they're not to enable them to get the maximum amount of nutrients out of it as possible. This also enables them to utilize areas that are quite dry and where the vegetation might not be the best. Okay, we're nearly back down on the southern boundary where we started this morning, and instead of going to the west, we're going to go to the east this time. Covering all our bases. It is going to be quite difficult to see tracks today, but hopefully the eyes are working, and hopefully Karula makes it easy for us. We don't have to track, maybe we'll just spot her. Okay, now we're back on the southern boundary. My head is going to be fixed to the ground again while I try check for tracks. So while we do that, let's go see what's happening on Arethusa with Byron.
So we've just crossed onto Arethusa. We're heading down to the southwest towards their airstrip, but just having a look at this beautiful rain in the distance. And actually, I'd like to show you something because we don't often get to see this. I'm just going to look for a little gap quickly. Hold on. I think up front we might get a gap through there. Scanning, also checking around these areas. Now, we have had wild dogs occasionally running through here recently on Arethusa, just the southern section. Apparently they've been getting glimpses of them. They haven't been hanging around. There we go, just through here perhaps. Hold on. Now, with all that rain at the moment, what's happening is it's obviously cleared up the air quite a bit. So it has settled all the dust and that kind of hazy view that we do get. But for the moment, you can see the Drakensberg mountain range clearly, very, very clearly in the distance. Now, that's the largest mountain range which runs through South Africa. Starts up right up in the northeastern part of South Africa and extends quite far south and then through across the central part of South Africa. And it basically separates the escarpment or the high-lying areas of South Africa to these lower-lying areas. So we're in an area known as the low veld. Our altitude here is much, much lower than that of the escarpment above, on top of the mountain range or through the mountain range. But it's very, very clear this morning. It looks like they've moved closer. Oh, that is a really, really beautiful, beautiful view. Nice to see how clear the air is after all this rain. I'm just going to help a friend down here quickly. He seems to be a little stuck. Come here. Oh, look at that. Hello. See if he's going to fly. There we go. Nice big dung beetle. Cindy, you wanted to know if because of that, we had that very big drought, that bad drought, you wanted to know if there was any anthrax around in the season. Cindy, I haven't seen any or heard of any reports yet. Fortunately now there's been quite a bit of rain, so that does help a lot. But no, I haven't heard of any outbreaks or any incidents. Beautiful area, this. A little bit more open, which is nice. Also, just scanning for any tracks, and I think I see some kudu. There we go. Some young kudu bulls, two of them. They will still get much bigger. Those horns will get a bit bigger, but beautiful to see them. One of the largest antelope that we have in this area. Those beautiful big ears. Now, the kudu do prefer moving through thickets. as we can see. And they've got those large ears to help listen out for potential predators in these thick areas. Now, you'd think that those kudu with those very, very long spiral horns would struggle to move through thickets like this, and especially if they've been chased by something. But incredibly, what they do is, if they do run away from anything, all they do is the males drop their heads. And I say the males because only the males have horns, not the females. As they're running, they'll just tilt their head back a little bit, and what it does is it pushes those horns straight back down along the back, and they're able to run through thickets very, very easily then, so they can get through the branches without those horns getting caught on them. Just tilt their heads back slightly. You can see there's a lot of little pans in that around at the moment. Little bit of water around. All these little pans have filled up. I think we've got somewhere around 15 or 20 mils of water of rain last night. And have a look here, just off to the right. I mean, this filled up quite a bit. Now, in these little mud wallows, possibly find little terrapins already moving around. But that's great. All that means, too, is that the animals can get water just about anywhere now. While they're walking around, they will drink from these little mud wallows or these little pools of water which are formed. Ilana, you want to know what is the difference between terrapins and turtles? So terrapins are basically just freshwater turtles. Turtles are generally, they live in salt water in the oceans. I think in the United States you've got a snapper turtle, which is much larger, but I don't know the exact habitat that it lives in. I know in swamplands and that, but I think because of the size, I think it also falls under the turtle family. But generally turtles live in seawater or salt water, and terrapins are smaller, much, much smaller, and live in fresh water. Some impala up ahead. Well, Michael, you wanted to know, while we were watching this impala, you wanted to know, what is anthrax? Is it a disease of sorts? And to be honest, I don't really like chatting about these diseases if there's no sign of them at all, because it can occasionally cause a bit of panic when there's no reason to panic, because there's no sign of anthrax at all, especially now we've had a lot of rain. So what happens is there are little spores, if I remember this correctly, tiny little spores which can be airborne, and it affects animals and can cause animals to die. It's a bacteria, if I'm not mistaken, which is usually caused by drought and very, very dry conditions. But at the moment we've got a lot of rain, so we don't have to worry about it at all. But it does affect animals and it does kill animals. So it is an airborne disease, and animals do pick up on it in droughts, in very, very severe droughts. Almost almost at the Arethusa airstrip. I wonder if there'll be any little creatures running around here in the open. What I'm going to do is, let's actually just go out and just scan around here. It's going to open up fairly soon. Very big airstrip this. I mean, these very open airstrips are often used by animals. And I'm just trying to have a look around here to our right. You can still see some of the impala that are moving off. As I was saying, these open areas, these open airstrips and that are often used by animals for safety in the evenings. You can just see some of the impala probably moving back into the thickets for the day to go and feed and look for food. I'm just scanning very carefully just to see if we can. James, you wanted to know what sort of antelope species we could potentially find on the Drakensberg in their mountain range. So up in those areas, we do get, I think there are mountain reedbuck which occur around there, but one of the more prevalent antelope that do occur in that area are the eland, the very, very large eland. Now, that is the largest antelope in Africa, and I'll show you a picture of one now. There we go. And they do enjoy mountainous areas. You can see that's the eland. They are massive. Some of the big eland bulls, just to give you an idea of size, can be larger than buffalo. They are very, very, very big antelope. Massive. They are incredibly large. Some of them can weigh up to 800 kilograms or a ton. That's really, really big. Also kudu, a lot of kudu up in those mountainous areas of the Drakensberg. Those would probably be the more common antelope up there. And then also you might find little antelope known as klipspringer. I'll show you a little picture of them now. Klipspringer, directly translated, means rock jumper. And there it is. It's a beautiful antelope. They do prefer rocky areas. You do get some of them up in those areas. That's the male and the female. They've got very interesting hoof structure, almost like little toes that these hooves form a little point, and it's almost like a rubberized hoof. Gives them a lot of grip on these very steep edges and rocky areas, and they're able to jump and spring from one rock to another very, very easily. And that's where the name Klipspringer means, rock jumper. Now we do get Klipspringer in this area too. It's just with the Klipspringers, we do get them in these areas within the Sabi Sands, and that I've seen many Klipspringers around, but this area that we operate on Juma, we don't have any little rocky outcrops, so we won't really see them out here. They do live and prefer rocky outcrops, but just south of us, so in that direction over there, just south of us, south of Arethusa, and you can actually see the landscape changes slightly. It does look as if it appears to dip down, and that leads towards a river known as the Sand River. And along the Sand River, there was their fault lines over thousands of years caused rocky outcrops to form along the edges of the Sand River. And those rocky outcrops are actually perfect homes for Klipspringer. So you do get them around there, and I've seen many Klipspringer around these areas. Right, I'm going to scan this airstrip a little bit more, have a look if we can't find Jackal. But let's head back to Brent and get an update from him.
Well, no success on Queen Karula just yet, but I got a radio call and I'm on my way to a surprise. I'm not going to tell you what it is. If you'd like to guess, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or questions@wildearth.tv on email. What surprise are Gert and Brent going to this morning? Oh, unfortunately, it just did happen to be on the complete opposite side of the reserve to where we were. We were in the sort of south middle part of the reserve, and whatever was found was right up in the western corner of the reserve. So rushed across quarantine. I'm now on the main access road heading towards that area. You never know what we might bump to on the way, though. There's always something out there, and that's the wonderful thing about being on a live African safari. Oh, wonder what it is, wonder what it is. Well, of course, I don't need to wonder, I know. Well, Sohrab thinks it might be wild dogs. Am I going fast enough for wild dogs? I don't know. Maybe. Maybe not. It might be a bird. Maybe. Could it be a thick-billed cuckoo? There's definitely still quite a lot of rain towards the Drakensberg. Dark skies up ahead, but as I said, very unusual for us to get weather from that side of the world. I don't think we had much rain last night. I don't think we even had 3 mils or 4 mils, so not too much, but it will help the grass. Hopefully Cheetah Plains got a bit more, as we were down there yesterday and you could see the sun was actually burning the grass. Pokemon guys, there's an aardvark, a honey badger, and maybe a pangolin. Wow, imagine all of those three together. I've never seen any of those together, but you never know. I've seen aardvark and leopard together, alive and dead. I've seen honey badger and lion together. I've seen pangolin and lion together. I've never seen an aardvark and lion together. One of the reasons a lot of those creatures, especially the aardvark, come out late at night around 11 o'clock is because it falls outside of the lion's most active window. So lions are generally quite active from sunset or just after sunset for the next two to three hours after there. So and this is from about 7 to 10, sometimes 11, and you find a lot of things like aardvark, pangolin will actually come out after that to avoid coming into contact with leopard and lion, who have a little bit of a lapse off. They go for another nap during that time. Not always, but as a general rule. Okay, we're now on the western boundary. Whoa, Aaron and Michael are hoping it's young Sindile, the male leopard. Well, I don't know. Could it be? We're going to have to wait to find out. So while I get towards that spot, let's go see what Steph's up to on foot.
Yes, good morning, and welcome to the bushwalk part of this morning's safari, or sunrise safari. I am Steph Vinterbrunn on camera today. We are VM. And you might be asking yourself, why do we walk around like this? Well, walking around is one of the ways that Africa has been explored, I suppose next to being explored on horseback, as the most, or the oldest way of getting around, really. And it just adds such a nice perspective to the vehicle-based safaris, which of course get you a lot closer to the bigger things. They have a slightly different priority to what we do. Our job out here is to walk into the middle of big undisturbed blocks of bush and to uncover whatever we can in there, both large and small, but I must be honest with you, mostly small. What are we doing today? Oh, as you may have been told by Brent, or by who else is out there today, Byron, that it rained last night, and there's quite a stiff breeze blowing around at the moment. The breeze is coming from this side here, which is, have a look at the blue sky. It's coming from our west and northwest. Usually wind that comes from the west or the northwest blows away the clouds. In this particular instance, I think it's doing exactly that. But what that does mean is we've got to put our faces into the wind and try as much as we can keep this breeze blowing into our faces. What that does is it takes all our scent and blows it away from the area that we're approaching. And that's just one of the ways that we keep ourselves safe over here. We don't want to disturb anything out here. We don't want to, if, as far as what we can, at least anyway, we want to walk around here unobserved and unobtrusive. And one of the ways we do that is using the wind direction. So we're going to be walking around probably the Jumek Dam area today, and on top of the crest there's a seep line there with a nest of a little bee eater, and we can go and visit that from time to time. I've been there over the last couple of months and it's been so nice. We actually managed to find the nest. It'd be nice to see if they've managed to fledge a chick in the meantime and see if there are more than one of the little bee eaters over there. So that's my plan. I'll probably get sidetracked along the way. It happens so often out here, and we'll see what happens. What else could we expect? I'd like to see an elephant, really. We haven't seen an elephant in an age on a bushwalk, and especially this time of the year. The big bulls are coming into the Sabi Sands. No one really knows why. Generally, they only really come for the marulas, which start to ripen up in about February and through to April, really. But right now, whoa, look at this. The granddaddy of all millipedes. This is incredible. Look at the size of this guy. That's my hand. He's a good, easily double my hand. He's come out after the rain, and that is about as big as a millipede gets here. That is massive. Easily just shy of a foot long. I don't actually know anywhere in the world that you get larger millipedes than here, to be honest. I'm sure you do. We are not a tropical environment whatsoever. In actual fact, we're savanna, almost semi-arid, I would imagine. And these types of animals and creatures do very, very well in marine environments, but they also do very, very well in rainforests. But just have a look at that. It's thicker than what my thumb is. That is incredible. got a covering of mud and sand from where he was hiding out during the storm, I would imagine. Probably in some cavity somewhere, or actually in this termite mound. Made up of many, many different segments. Let's see if you wouldn't mind me picking me up. Sometimes these big millipedes don't mind you picking them up. But just have a look. I'll give you my... I'm a size 9 shoe, and that is about as long as my foot is. That's massive. They're detritivores, mainly. I'll tell you something interesting that I learned just the other day. So what does detritivore mean? It means that they feed on composting material, on compost basically. They eat fungus, they eat algae, they eat dead and dying leaves and trees and branches. But they will also feed on dead and dying insects. And the other day, a friend of mine, acquaintance really, more than a friend, managed to take a sequence of photographs which showed a millipede approaching a dying locust, wrapping the locust up in its coils, and then starting to feed on it. Isn't that incredible? So in that sense, you could say that it was a scavenger, perhaps carnivore, because the animal wasn't dead yet. Just have a look here. I'm gonna walk. He doesn't like me going around his business end. He said one of his feelers have been chopped off in a fight or something. That is how they see their world, is those antennae that's waving around there in the front. Jay, you wanted to know if millipedes have a smell. Jay, you can see some of its dung there. That has a smell, absolutely. And more than a smell, they've got a taste, believe it or not. Underneath their legs, where their legs come out of their bodies, let's see if I can open it there again, there are pores there, and those pores exude a hydrocyanide, which coats the top of the millipede and makes them taste incredibly bad. Now what you might find on big millipedes like this are travelers as well. Let's see if we can find some mites. Quite often they're infested with mites. This one is very clean. He hasn't got any mites at all. And what the mites do is keep him clean as well. Living in the environment where he lives, or she lives, it's actually an it, they're hermaphroditic. They pick up any number of fungi that grow on their bodies, and mites will live on their bodies, cleaning them off. I think we've played with this guy enough. We'll leave him going in his original direction. Ilana, you've just asked me how many legs do millipedes have. They get their name milli, meaning thousand, and pedi, meaning legs, but they don't really have 1,000 legs. What they have got is they've got 2 legs per segment, 2 pairs of legs per segment. So you can take a screen grab here, a picture. Let's do that with you. Let's see if we can get him to sit still so that you can grab a picture. There we go. And then in your leisure time, you can count how many segments he's got. The first 4 segments only have 1 pair of legs, and the last segment has 1 pair of legs. Every other segment has 2 pairs of legs. And then you can absolutely see how many legs this, and this is a very long one. They will very rarely have more legs than this. Crawling right into your screens this morning. All right, on that note, we're going to be sending you over to Brent, who's got a surprise for you.
Well, well done to Safari Shay. You were correct. It is indeed the Nkuhumas. Only 4 of them. So it probably Amber Eyes, who's still missing. She's probably out with them four more. Last we heard in Buffalo's Hook. But look at that fat bellies. Now, apparently they did kill two buffalo when they went visiting our neighbours. But lovely to have them back. They're not far inside Juma at the moment, probably only 50 or 60 metres. So far I counted four cubs, but I think there are some others behind this bush here where there's another adult lioness. So I think all the cubs are here. We will move around just now, but at the moment this is the best spot. There we go. There we go. You can see a few more behind. So we can see four in total, but I'm sure the others can't be too far off around the corner. And we got some cleaning going on the right. So the only lioness missing is Amber Eyes, and as I said, we think she's with the authority, Mfumo. She might be coming into estrus, so that's why she's not with the pride. Can't see any males with them at the moment, but that doesn't mean Dino is not lying about here somewhere. Hey, little guy. They definitely have picked up condition, and picked up condition quickly. And as soon as they did, you can see they've started moving distances again, which they weren't doing for about 10 days or so during the height of the white muscle disease. Very peaceful, serene sighting this morning. Doesn't look like they've got a kill around here, even though last night would have been ideal hunting weather. I think their bellies were just too big to make the effort. Remember the hashtag Safari Live or the email address questions@wildearth.tv if you'd like to ask us any questions. Waiting for Aubrey, and thanks to Aubrey for finding them, to move out, and then we'll try get into a better spot. I know a lot of you are very happy to see the Nkuhumas back on Juma. Okay, Aubrey's out. Let's just try a maneuver, see if we can see the rest of the cubs. Go. Let's do a quick cub count. Okay, so there's one sleeping behind that line. There's 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. All present and accounted for. have probably walked from where they were yesterday 4 Ks, 4 kilometers, 5 kilometers. Kay is wondering, is there still a chance of mange now that it's rained? Well, Kay, generally things like mange are prevalent when it's very dry, and the mites seem to not do so well in the wet. Now, I mean, there's always a chance, but it's highly unlikely. I think the danger of mange has passed with every little raindrop we get. It becomes less and less the chances of mange taking over become less and less. Even the little cubbies have nice fat bellies. Arlena is wondering, how do lions get TB? And, well, they generally get it from buffalo, bovine tuberculosis that transmits into feline TB. Mutates, should I say, is the correct word. But so far with this set of Inkahuma cubs and the adults, I don't see any signs of TB. What's happened over the last 10 years, now this is not fact, but it's looking more and more likely, it's my theory, is that when the lions first started contracting TB from the buffalo, there was a massive influence on the lion populations. And this is where genetics and not getting involved becomes a very important thing, because as you just leave them alone and you let the TB work through the cats, some of the prides get completely wiped out, and obviously they don't have a good genetic resistance to that, where there is a lot of the prides now probably carry TB, but it has no adverse effects on them. We're not seeing those lumps on elbows on the neck like you normally see in TB lions. So you probably find there might be carriers, but it's now almost not mundane, but inert, that their genetics are strong enough to deal with it. Oh, it's seen a bug. Oh, it's a biting fly. Bite it. There we go. Now she's probably going to jump up and walk over to one of the other lionesses. Now, lions are quite funny because often they'll just flop on top of another lioness. Now, who are you gonna go flop on? Or are you gonna go flop on someone? Oh, she's got a thorn in her bum. There you can see a little thorn stick stuck in it. Doesn't seem to be affecting her at all. She might be just going to find another spot to lie down. I'm hoping they might get moving, but it's going to be difficult to see. With those fat bellies, and they've moved quite far overnight, there's a good chance that they're just going to snooze in this area. There's enough shade around. There's water close by. Now, I know a lot of you, when you're lying down or watching Safari Live, you like to put your feet up. And here, our lions also like to do that from time to time. And if we have a look at this lioness, there we go. She's got a nice footrest in a little sickle bush or Dicrostachys. She looks quite comfortable. I'm quite jealous. So it's going to be interesting to see if Amber Eyes joins up with them at some time. She has looked the last time we saw her like she was trying to find the pride, but then she lost them and she went the wrong way. She went north instead of south, west. So they are heading back towards where she was. She was about a kilometer and a half inside Buffalo's Hook on yesterday's sunset safari. Hi, Liz. Liz in Chicago is wondering, does estrus happen monthly for lions? Well, no, it doesn't. Once they've had babies, Liz, they will suppress their estrus cycle till those babies are big enough to mate for themselves. So till, if it's a male lion, till they disperse and go look for their own pride, or if it's a female, till she's sexually viable. Till then, the mothers will not have an estrus cycle. And you see another lioness using a different foot rest, but while the Nkuhumas are napping, I'm going to sit chat, see what they get up to next. But let's go see what Byron's plans are.
We've just come to a beautiful little waterhole that's filled up a lot during the course of the evening with some rain. But listen to all the frogs. Isn't that amazing? Wonderful, wonderful sounds. Some rain frogs, some painted reed frogs. A lot of them here at the moment. A lot of frogs. It's incredible. I can't see a single one. I can just hear them. I've been scanning, looking carefully with binoculars. Can't see them. But this cacophony of frog calls coming from this little waterhole after the rain. And then another beautiful bird sitting at the top of this very dead tree, top right-hand branch. That one over there, genre. Top right is a hoopoe. Let's see if we can get it there. There it's sitting, it's calling non-stop. There it is. The African hoopoe. Beautiful call. Some wonderful sounds coming from this area at the moment. Bird calls and the frog calls. Really beautiful spot. We caught a glimpse of something interesting earlier as we were just driving around this open clearing, a glimpse of a white-tailed mongoose, which is very interesting, especially for this time of the morning. They're generally nocturnal. I'll show you a picture of one, those who don't know what a white-tailed mongoose looks like. It's the largest mongoose species in Africa. Let's see if I can find it quickly. Hang on. And like I said, they're mainly nocturnal, so to see one running around early in the morning is very interesting. I'm trying to find it. Where is it? Very, very large mongoose. I wonder if they've got a picture of a white-tailed mongoose in here. Not a very good one, but that's a picture of a white-tailed mongoose. Doesn't really do it any justice. They're generally much darker with very large, bushy white tails. And as I said, they're mainly nocturnal. I don't know where this picture is from. But to see one running around in the morning like this through the clearing is very interesting. And just a quick little view and it disappeared so quickly. Very, very shy little creatures. A big bird of prey that's just flying over us. What is that? That's interesting. I wonder why that bird, let's see if I can have a closer look at it. Flew away from us. It looked like perhaps a tawny eagle or a steppe buzzard. So some of you might be wondering where I am. You haven't seen this pan before. We're just off Arethusa airstrip. And I think it's just because of all the rain that's filled up now. There goes that bird. Oh. It looked like a tawny eagle. I think I might be able to get a view of it for you. Hold on. Through here. It looked like a tawny eagle that took off, possibly feeding on some termites. They do that occasionally, especially after a lot of rain. When all these termites are active, you do get some of these larger birds of prey coming down and feeding on the termites. Let's see if I can. It doesn't look like it's flown off. It's still sitting up in this tree. It's just quite a thick little tree. You can kind of get it through there, Jean-Ray. Can you see? So we're in that marula, the main left-hand stem, sitting just next to... There we go. There it is. It does look like a tawny eagle. Beautiful, beautiful color. It's just hiding in those branches at the moment. Let's just double check. I'll show you some of the eagle species that look quite similar. But I think this coloration is probably spot on with this picture of the tawny eagle. Have a look at that. So fortunately with these apps you do have photographs of some of the there we go. How's that? There you can see that coloration clearly. And one of the things we look for is the beak and the cere, how far back it goes. Generally with the tawny it does go quite far back, almost to the back of the eye around there. And also tawny eagles tend to look a little bit ruffled. Their feathers always look a little bit ruffled. I'll show you another bird quickly that looks similar. Steppe eagles sometimes. And look how similar that steppe eagle looks. And this is an immature steppe eagle, this picture, but very, very similar to the tawny eagle. Let's just see if there's another picture of one here. There we go, you can see him sitting there too. See, but now that cere, the little cere at the back there is meant to extend beyond the eye, but like I say, it's so difficult to actually have a good look at it. And I do think we get it wrong sometimes, to be honest, because it's not always easy to see, even with binoculars and scanning and trying to have a look at these eagles quickly and when they're hiding through trees, to really have a good look and gauge whether or not it is a steppe eagle or tawny eagle, if the coloration is so similar and if you don't get a good look at that cere. And again, I wonder how accurate that is, because from the pictures that I've shown you, it looks like they're almost exactly the same. But I do think that this is a tawny eagle. Right, we're going to continue moving through this area. Just having a look around these clearings that we've passed through and see if there's anything else interesting around here. While I do that, let's head back to Steph on the bushwalk and see what he's up to.
Quite nice jumping from Arethusa, from where Byron is all the way to us. I would suppose that it's about 10 miles from where he is at the moment. It's relatively far. You come over in an instant looking at birds in the sky with Byron to coming to look at this funny patch of white deposit that you're seeing over here. Now what this is, it's a latrine site for an African civet. They use toilet sites to mark out their territory. And it's a little bit like playing crime scene investigations because it tells you what is the most predominant food source in that area or in this area at this time for the civet. And because they're omnivorous and have this really wide diet, you can tell what the bush is doing by coming to one of these sites, these newsstands, for lack of a better word. So why don't we go through the civet deposits and we see what we can find, what the civet's been eating. This is immediately noticeable in that it's the belly of a scorpion, I think. Is it a scorpion? Yeah, it's the scorpion. So this is the main body of a scorpion, and here some tail segments of a scorpion, probably the same scorpion. Here we go. Let's see what else we can find over here. Of note is baby tortoises. So this civet has been feeding on a young tortoise. That's a scute from a tortoise. Many millipedes. All of these white pieces here and here are the segments of a millipede. Let's see if we can find something else interesting here. Here is a dung beetle. So the front foot of a dung beetle, or one of the feet of a dung beetle. So here we've got a dung beetle, tortoise, scorpion so far. We've got the seeds from a jackalberry. Actually, no, that's a beetle casing again. Another beetle casing. Wow, this is interesting. Here we have another type of beetle, not a dung beetle. That is a tuktuki beetle, a tenebrionid beetle. We've got some more scorpion coming out. It's another tail segment of a scorpion. Obviously not much nutrition in the tail itself once the meat has gone out the inside. Let's break open one of these boluses and see what's inside. So no seeds of anything, just insects, many millipedes. Now sometimes in some areas these dung piles can be filled with mice's vertebrae, ribs, teeth, claws. They will catch and kill mice, but this particular civet in this particular area doesn't seem to have much more than what we've collected here. So to go through it again, scorpions are forming a piece of the diet, baby tortoises, dung beetles, and tuktuki beetles, tenebrionid beetles, all fairly large beetles. Let's see what else is going on here. I'm dearly wanting to show you a mouse's leg bone female tibia. Now, Lucy, you've made an interesting observation. You've asked why would the millipede remains go white? Lucy, they are chitin, and chitin is made up of calcium carbonate mainly, and calcium carbonate bleaches white in the sun. So it's the calcium that you're seeing inside there just bleaching white in the sun, and it's because they're made of this substance called chitin, which a lot of the insects are covered with, and so that's why it goes white in this particular environment. Lots of sunshine out here. See another big beetle. Let's see if we can identify that beetle. What is interesting is they're only eating ground living beetles. They're not catching beetles inside trees. That would make sense, I suppose. Civets don't really climb trees if they don't have to. Break open another bolus over here. Now you notice I'm using a stick rather than my hands, and that is because civets are omnivorous and they do eat meat from time to time. And what I don't want to do is touch something's dung out here that eats a lot of meat. And some of these civet trees can get absolutely massive. Civets live for relatively long periods of time. I'm not quite sure exactly how long they live, but they definitely live for longer than a few years. And they will use these civet trees for years and years and years at a time, making these huge deposits in areas. And they'll almost always be in exposed areas, and they approach these with caution. They spend a lot of time sniffing around these civet trees, making a deposit of dung and urine, and then moving off it as their territorial marking place. It's quite interesting, eh? Now, James, you wanted to know what's the most unusual thing I've ever found in a civet tree. James, I suppose it has to be these mice deposits. The one civet tree that I used to visit from time to time, deep on the other side of the Kruger National Park, on the Lebombo mountain range, was on a rock. And these rocks had these depressions in them caused by lichen, and they used to make these cups. And this civet tree would wash over the season, over the wet season, and deposit bones into this variety of these little pools, basically. And then the pools would dry up in the winter time, and you could go there and almost put an entire skeleton together of these mice. No bones broken. It's almost like the civet caught the mouse, shook it to break its neck, and then swallowed the mouse whole, and it came out the other end literally with all the bones pretty much intact still. So it's not unusual, but it's definitely unexpected out there. Let's go to this one and see. So more scorpions. This particular dung, or this particular evening, was very good for scorpions, as you can see there and there and there and there, and more beetles. All right, we have now finished playing in our dung pile. I'm going to wash my hands, and we're going to send you over to Brent. He's got a surprising pride for you.
So we're still within Cormors. There's not much going on here, and we've just moved a little bit closer. As you can see, they're very, very relaxed at the moment, and I know this young lion with a floppy ear is a firm favorite with lots of our viewers out there. Now that floppy ear could be from mange, it could also be from stable flies. It could also be from a physical injury. Be impossible to know for sure. I said, with all these big bellies, it's very unlikely to be much movement with the pride today. Well, this morning at least. Now, no love there. Go look somewhere else. And of course, lions and lionesses are quite different looking with their manes, but there's one incredible, unusual fact that they share. Now if we, oh look at that, I'll wait for them to finish playing. Oh, isn't that sweet? There you go, you saw that biting of the ear. So see, something like that, but probably a hard bite around a carcass could cause a floppy ear. But I think it's probably more to do with mange and flies, personally. As I said, we'll never know for sure. Now, Curry's wondering, where are the male lions? And why don't the lionesses have manes? Well, they don't really need manes. The manes are there for protection during fights. They're also there to make a male look more impressive to try avoid fights. So the bigger and scarier you look, the less likely another lion wants to fight with you. But male lions fight far more regularly than lionesses and far more seriously in defensive territory. So they've got that massive bit of hair around their necks to help protect the vulnerable areas around the throat and the back of the neck. Now, we're talking about, oh, here we go, there's one zap. Now, some of the lions are definitely fatter than the others, but overall, they all look quite well fed. Now, if we look at that end of her tail, that tuft in her tail. Now, lions are the only big cats to have a tuft at the end of their tail, and there's a hard spine or spur that's about 5 mils long that's formed as the last bones of their tailbone fuse together. Now, it's quite interesting because no one really knows why it's happened. I mean, we know it's a following mechanism, but what prompted that? And if we try, where's a cub now? Let's go try this one here. Now, we look at the little cubs. Those bones only fuse when they're about 5.5 to 6 months old. So, and then the tufts are only really developed from 7 months old. So when they're young, they don't have that very distinct tuft with the black hair, and those bones haven't fused together. Now, of course, we know it's a very useful following mechanism for other lions to follow lions through the bush. But where it came from and why those bones fused together is quite interesting, because if you think about a leopard, or it's got a white tuft, a tip to the tail, but it's not a tuft, so they don't have those fused bones. And that's also used as a following mechanism, but they haven't had to evolve that fusing. So it's quite an interesting thing, one of those amazing little mysteries. There we go, you can see there the tuft hasn't formed properly yet, so those bones have not yet fused together. It's probably started fusing together, but we're only going to be able to see it clearly at about 7 months old. Elena is wondering, when the male Inkahuma cubs grow up and get pushed from their natal or home territory by the Birminghams and to a degree by the females themselves, will they form a coalition? It's very likely. I'm just trying to remember. I'm not sure. I've forgotten now how many males, how many females. But remember, we've lost two, and I can't remember the sexes of them. If anyone out there knows how many male cubs, how many female cubs are left out of the six that we have, I'm pretty sure they're more females than males. But if you know, let me know. Hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. Oh, some complaining. Just trying to sneak in there. Looks like it's been a success. Now, David's wondering, at what age do the cubs start losing the black behind their ears? Now, I'm just trying to see if we can see the behind the lioness's ear. Let's have a look at this there. Now, you can see it's still black there, but it's quite patchy, and they don't really ever lose that black. It just becomes a little bit more dull, and most of that is because of biting flies, actually, biting incessantly on the ears and causing their hair to fall out, the stable flies. Now, so far we haven't had really bad outbreaks of stable flies in this area, but in other parts of Africa there have been incredibly bad outbreaks of stable flies that have caused actually our lions to actually move out of an area or to even die. So it is quite interesting, and it happens. The last place that happened most frequently was in Tanzania and Kenya, if I remember correctly. Oof, thirsty. Now, on average, our Kruger lions are a bit bigger than the East African lions. So, a male is around 200 kilograms, and in this area, and in East Africa, the males are around 170 kilograms. So, not massive difference, but they are definitely, on average, bigger animals, and the lionesses as well. I seem to have found an amicable peace now, not so much roaring at each other. Well, it's hard to believe that these little tykes, when they were born, were only about 4.5 pounds in weight. They are now already, all of them, much, much larger than a domestic cat. They probably, you know, I suppose, only within the first 3 weeks of life are they the same size or same weight as a domestic cat. Hi, Deborah, the armchair traveller, what you heard? Now, Deborah would like to know, at what age does the size difference between male and female lion cubs become apparent? So anything from now, Deborah, from around 6 months onwards, you can start seeing the difference. The males also start to develop a little scraggly sort of chin fluff. Okay, I've just got to be on the Game Drive channel quickly. Andrew is trying to find where we are. We're not visible from the road, so I'm just going to chat to him quickly. Oh, they're complaining again. Andrew, I'm the only station here. You're more than welcome to join. If you come on Triple M, almost directly opposite One Eye Pan, you'll see the tracks going east into the block. Byron saw this morning at around Philemon's Dip junction with Zoe's Road. Sorry about that. Just letting Andrew know. Now, it's very important to stay in communication with all the other vehicles. Now, it's the best way for all of us to find the best sightings. So, Aubrey found these lions this morning, and we have to thank him for that. And it does go through stages where everyone's, or each individual seems to find more than the other, but it all evens out over time because we all share our sightings. The sun is coming out, which means as the sun moves higher in the sky, some of the lions might end up in the sun and it could cause them to move slightly. But as I said, I don't think they're going to move too far today. I think unless something stumbles onto them for breakfast, I think they're probably going to be sleeping in this area for the majority of the day. Dinga is wondering what are the trees they're lying under. Well, I'm not sure what that little cub's up to because he's going into the middle of a bush. The bush that he is, or she is, I couldn't see, disappearing into is a white berry bush. And I don't know what could be that interesting that you want to go all the way inside there. Maybe thinks it might have some respite from the biting flies. And the one closest to us, that's in between, this one that's in between us and the lion cub, is called a weeping wattle. Yes, maybe he's found a fly-free spot in the thicket. Now, the rest of the trees, as we head off slightly to the right, those bigger ones there are gorry bushes. Those are not gwarri bushes, the ones to the left, sorry. That one there is a gwarri bush. And the one that Khat was showing to the right is a bush willow. So even though it was stormy and rainy last night, it is still quite warm, still humid. And I wonder if that means we're going to get any more rain later in the day, especially if it builds up again with this heat and humidity. Oh, heavy eyelids. Now, if any of you at home like sleeping, then if you ever come back as an animal, you want to be a lion, because they sleep for about 20 hours a day. And even those 4 hours of activity are generally in short bursts, active for 10 or 20 minutes or even 40 minutes, then sleep for an hour, active again for half an hour, sleep for 20 minutes. And a lot of their movement depends on how full they are. Looks like she might have heard something in the bush to the west of us. Nothing too interesting, not enough to make her stand up and go investigate. Very peaceful Nguma sighting this morning. Everyone relaxing. But the amazing thing is you never know. Oh, look at that. Well, fast asleep. Oh, the flies after the rain could be quite a not a problem, but irritating for the lions. Lucy. Lucy's wondering about that floppy ear. Will it affect the hearing? Probably a little bit, Lucy, but not too much. As you can see, it can still move the ear. There's still some cartilage in it. Oh, some wonderful bird calls around. I'm just gonna move forward a little bit. Okay, here we go. So behind us, on the opposite side of the lines, okay, let's just see where it's flicked to now. Murphy's, oh, there it is. Oh, there it's gone. Oh dear, well, it's disappeared. And on that note, we're gonna go back to Steph and see how their tracking is going.
Talking about birds, this is forming such an important meal for the birds at the moment. This is the white berry bush, and I know we speak about it from time to time on Bushwalk, but it's only because they provide you with a tasty snack while you're wandering through the bush like we are. Mmm, that is good. They're starting to get much riper now, literally by the day. You're finding bushes with some ripe ones on. They're ripe when they are white. When they're slightly green, like those ones that you're looking at right now, they've got a bittery taste to them. Not quite bad, but the second they go white, they get very sweet. Here's one that's white. That's about as ripe as they get. And then you can just pile them in. Another quite fresh plant out here is this. This is a apple leaf tree. And I love picking the leaves of apple leaf trees. They've just got such a refreshing sound. I quite enjoy green apples. And it gets this name from the crunch that the leaf makes when you crunch it. Let's see if I can put it next to my microphone for you and show you. Oh, hang on. That wasn't a dry one. That was too fresh. Epic fail. Let me find you a fresh one. There's a bit of a better one, I think. Let's see if this one will work. No, still not dry. Too wet, too much rain. What's happening to me today? No, not working today. Leaves are too new and it's been too much rain. Oh, anyway, let's carry on going. Try and recover some of my lost pride after that. Mm. We're getting into some parkland now, which is quite pleasant to walk through these areas. This particular area of Juma, we're in the center of Juma, really. And this parkland that you see is by design almost. The elephants have knocked down a lot of the big trees. And as we approach the seepline, it becomes more and more difficult for the trees to take root again because of the high water content that's lying quite close to the surface here. And so you get these grasslands that develop underneath these trees, and the trees are quite widely spaced from one another. And it just gives this very nice open area to walk through. It's just nice. You don't have to worry about what buffalo is going to be jumping out of a bush at you, or what elephant herd is hidden by a thicket. Sammy Soccer, walking around over here, I suppose this is where this question came from. You've asked, do we have poison ivy around here? Sammy Soccer, we don't have poison ivy, no, but we do have a fireweed. Although it's this particular fireweed that grows here is a vine that grows around trees close to drainage lines. So every now and again you walk past a piece of fireweed and it has these hairs on it with some toxins coating it. That is unbelievably painful. It feels like somebody's taken acid and poured it on your skin. But we don't have these thickets of poison ivy here, not at all. This is a blackjack, and at this particular size you can boil this in some water, and the leaves make for quite a nutritious vegetable. So not like a tuber, it's not going to give you a lot of carbohydrates, but it just is a nice addition to your diet. It's got this very pleasant peppery smell, almost like a rocket, I would imagine. So this you could sprinkle over your salad, no problem. Oh, it did add a nice taste to it as well. They're better when you cook them. Doesn't have an unpleasant taste at all. Very similar to rocket. Not as peppery the taste, but not unpleasant. I wouldn't mind it sprinkled lightly over a salad myself. All right, let's carry on going and see what is happening over here. Just make it easy for VM to come through here without getting all tied up. It's a nice day today. It's overcast, wind is blowing a bit. I thought this was a plant that it isn't. This is one of the weeds. It gets a big, fleshy purple flower with a yellow back. I'll see if I can find you one. All right, and on that note, and while we carry on trying to find some breakfast snacks for you, I'm gonna send you over to Byron all the way in Arethusa.
No, we carried on driving around Arethusa. No sign of the secretary birds or jackals that we were looking for on the airstrip, on the clearings. We had one impala alarm calling, but it was alarm calling at us. So we're probably going to move out of this area now, go back past the airstrip. Just see, but it does seem to be fairly quiet here this morning. But you never know, just like last night, driving around, you bump into things all the time, and it could be a leopard or it could be anything for that matter. And still a lovely, very, very beautiful morning. The air is so clear because of that rain that we had last night. And the cloud cover, there's a bit of cloud cover around, but the sun is shining and it's a beautiful, beautiful morning. Very, very peaceful. You can hear some woodland kingfishers calling in the distance. It's a little bit too far. I don't think you'd be able to hear it, unfortunately. That wonderful beautiful sound. Bonnie, you'd like to know if we see a little bird called a Jamison's firefinch. We do get them in this area, and usually, funnily enough, Bonnie, and I actually like to show everyone what the Jamison's firefinch looks like, because it is such a beautiful bird. Let me just get it for you quickly. Now, Bonnie, they often found in, believe it or not, but in little garden areas and that around lodges, because where there's lovely, where there's bits of water in that and seeds that they can feed on and little plants that they can hide in. They are really, really beautiful little birds. And I will find it. There it is. Actually, let me just tilt it this way for you. And that's the image that you would see in the books. Jamison's firefinch, but I'll show you a picture of one, a photograph, which is a lot better. Have a look at that beautiful little reddish pink underneath, and slightly there we go, slightly brownish wings. Very, very beautiful bird. Let me see if there's another little picture of one. Some have got little white specks on them at times. But that's the Jamison's firefinch. We do get them in the area. I just haven't seen one on Juma, though. Not yet. But like I said, little garden areas, areas where there's bird baths, food for them to feed on, generally dense little thickets, and they fly around between the bushes. That's the general habitat of the firefinch. Very, very beautiful little birds. approaching the airstrip again. So let's have a look if there isn't perhaps something that's come out now into the clearing. Do know these side-striped jackal do enjoy the clearings, they enjoy these open areas, and you do find them around here at times. Don't see anything here at the moment, unfortunately. And just again, just have a look how clear the sky is off to our left. Oh, there's brakes. Very, very clear, and you can see the Drakensberg mountain range clearly in the distance. That's what I was saying, after this rainfall now, everything's settled, the dust is settled, the air's cleared up. It's really, really lovely. But it appears as if that mountain range has moved closer because you can see them so clearly. And at times of the year, especially in winter, when you have a lot of dust in the air and a lot of it's not air pollution, but it gives the air a very hazy effect. You can sometimes not see those mountains at all. It's incredible what the rain does. It's quite windy out in this clearing around the airstrip. I'm not sure how much rain the DRC did get last night. I think we got between 15 and 20 mils, judging from what I've heard other guys speaking about. But I'm not exactly sure how much rain we got. We'll have to try and find out and see if we can give you all an update this afternoon at how much rain we got last night. We're going to be heading back towards Juma, Vuyatela. Let's head back to Brent and get an update from him.
Well, as you can see, not much movement here with the Nkuhuma Pride. They're still fast asleep. I think we're going to probably make our way out of here shortly. I don't think we're going to see too much action. I was just waiting to see if they possibly might get moving, but looking at them now, it doesn't look like it. Now, I have heard Madam Amber, and what I'm presuming is the authority have also been found. I'm just going to give Byron a call, see if he's closer. Byron. Oh no, I forgot. Byron's still on Arethusa. He's still on Arethusa. He's on a different radio channel. That was my fault. I wasn't thinking very clearly this morning. There we go. Doing a little bit of grooming. But as I said, I'm pretty sure they're going to be right here for the sunset safari. Now, Anna's wondering is how can a lion's tongue rasp skin and meat off a carcass but not harm themselves when they're grooming? Well, I think they collect a lot of that fur while they're using their tongue, and also I don't think they lick with quite the same vigor as they would on a carcass. And you see there, you probably find most of what That cub's getting his fur. Now, if you've got a domestic cat at home and you've ever been licked by it, now you've felt how rough, almost like sandpaper, their tongue is. Now, a lion's just a much bigger, harder, more robust version of that tongue. Okay, it sounds like Byron's quite far away, so we are going to start moving and making our way towards whatever else is around. Ooh, I've just got another report. It sounds like it's not only Mfumo, it sounds like there's three males there. So I'm definitely going to head that way. Station with those and guys, I'd like to join you. I'm still quite a long way out though, so if anyone's closer, please go ahead. Okay, now we've got to pick our way out of here. As I said, this is a particularly thick area. Okay, I think I'm gonna turn around. I see a route out. Been a long time since we've seen three of the Birmingham boys together, so it could be quite exciting to go have a look. It sounds like there is a kill there in the area as well, so let's trundle along, and who knows, maybe we'll find Queen Karula on the way. Now, of course, the lions seem to be making us go from one end of Juma to the other. Those three males and amber eyes are on the far opposite side of Juma. So while we make our way there, Steph is looking at some of the plants we get here on Juma.
I need to turn around and walk in the opposite direction. It seems like there are lions everywhere here around us in this sort of arc in front of us. It's awesome. But while you've been away with others, Stephanie has asked me a question about, is there mistletoe and mopani worms here? Yes to both questions. There's mistletoe here and many different kinds of mistletoe, with the most common mistletoe being the Kalahari mistletoe, growing exclusively and at the top of knobthorn trees. The answer to your second question about mopani worms is also yes, although not as many as you find in the Mopani Belt, which lies about, from here, probably about 80 to 90 kilometers away north of where we are. The Mopani Belt starts, and there you find large concentrations of mopani worms. Here, the mopani worms tend to favor jackalberry trees, and you do find lots of mopani worms here on jackalberry trees, depending on the year, really. I had a look through a jackalberry tree 2 or 3 days ago to see if there were any mopani worms that I could see, and it's a little bit early for them. They come out in around about November. You see them, tiny little worms like this, when they hatch, literally just covering the ground in any direction. They move up into the mopani trees, and you can actually sit still on a windless day and you can hear them eating the leaves around you. It's just the most surreal, weird experience you've had, and I highly recommend it. And of course then, by the end of the season, around about Christmas time, January time, the worms are big enough that you can squeeze them out and you can pop them into a pot, boil them, fry them, you can just eat them raw, whatever you need to do. They are a huge delicacy, even sold in the shops here. They package them, dry them and package them and sell them in the shops here. That's how many there are. All right, we are walking pretty much in exactly the opposite direction to where those lions were called in. Not because we need to worry about lions on foot. I mean, of course you have to worry about lions on foot, but because we will disturb those cats if we walk into that area and bump into them. And of course we want to try and get Brent or Brian, or it would be Brent because he's here, Byron's in Arethusa. We'd get Brent and you there as soon as he gets to that sighting. So we don't want to bump into them, we don't want to cause them to run away or run at us. That's not what we want to do. So we're walking in the opposite direction, changed our plan a little bit. Not to worry. any direction over here is pretty much as exciting as any other direction here for me, so it's not too much of a concern, to be honest. All right, now let's see what this is. Jason, you've asked me an interesting question, one I haven't been asked in many, many years. You've asked, are there sundews in Juma or any other carnivorous plants? Yes, there are. However, I'm just busy trying to rack my brain. There are sundews here. I'm just trying to rack my brain to think if there are any fly traps here. Other than that, no. There's just the sundews that we find here, and we find them deep in summer, so from January all the way through to about the end of March, and they like these pools, still pools, and they grow right on the edge of the water. They're water loving plants, and so we hopefully we'll be able to show you some from January through to about February or so. I don't think there are any other carnivorous plants around at all, not that I can think of. Have a look at this awesome thing here. This is the very camouflaged entrance to a massive baboon spider's hole. She must have been living here forever and ever. Look at that. She's managed to stick all these leaves to the entrance of her burrow using silk, and just have a look at the diameter of that hole. Now, baboon spiders are the South African equivalent of tarantulas. They're our tarantula or megalomorph, as we call them, and this is the hole of the largest megalomorph that we find out here. This is the entrance tunnel to the golden brown baboon spider, a spider that is bigger than my hand, and you can see her next to my face. You'll see that with legs and everything extended, this female spider, I would presume, is this big with an abdomen that thick. One of the massive, most massive of the spiders. The biggest one that we find in this. But what is unique is the fact that this spider, over the years, has accumulated this camouflaged entrance and is using it to hide herself. Of course, tarantulas or baboon spiders that live in holes like this, they, when they become adult and they molt from adolescence into adulthood, they actually lose the appendage that they were born with to dig with, and so they will live sedentary. The females will live sedentary in these holes for the rest of their lives, and they live up to 25 years old. So from very young to, they will live in these holes up to 20 years. Isn't that incredible? And of course, if you had to dig her out, even if we were to entice her out and she got lost and couldn't find her hole, she wouldn't be able to dig a new one. And because of her size, moving around at night would be very dangerous for her. She would be an easy snack for lots of nighttime birds, as well as lots of little nocturnal predators as well. See if you can see her. Now, Wendy, you've asked, can I find you a baboon spider today? This is about as close as we could get to a baboon spider without me having to fish her out of the hole. We could fish her out of the hole. It's relatively harmless to the spiders, and we can see if she'd be partial to being teased out of the hole. Let me just see if I can find... I'll tell you how we do it safely. I won't tease her out of the hole if I can't find the exact piece of grass that I'm looking for. Let me see if I can do it. Here we go. Wait there, I'm coming back to you now. No, that's not it. Because we've had such a... Here we go, let's see if we can use this. So, when you are fishing for baboon spiders, the key to not hurting them is to use as soft a grass as you can. So, I use this end of the grass, no spikes, soft, and the reason for that is that you just want to tease the spider. You want to tease the entrance to the burrow and get the spider to come to the grass. You don't want to get them to grab onto the grass. And if you use a sharp end or you use a stick, quite often as the stick comes sliding down the tunnel, it will bump into the sides. And you don't really know what is the baboon spider and what is the side. And very easily you can slip under the baboon spider and you can actually puncture the body of the baboon spider. So if you're ever going to be fishing for baboon spiders, you always use the soft grasses. It's completely harmless to the spider. It creates no disturbance whatsoever. Let me show you how we're going to do it. You twirl it, and then you stick it into the entrance, and you just create a little disturbance. You can see all that silk covering the tips of the grass. That makes it easier to get inside. So now we're creating a disturbance. If the spider is active, and it's got a lot to do with ambient temperature, on very hot, dry days, they are more active, actually evenings really, than they are during the day. And if she's active, she will come and push out the piece of grass. And that is when we get to see her. Let's see if she comes. Any other way of fishing out a baboon spider, I would recommend against. As you can see, her silk has covered the grass tuft and has provided me with a probe that is a little bit more robust, but completely soft. And so absolutely no danger to her whatsoever. Any other way, any stick, sharp piece of grass, anything, you run the risk of puncturing her, and then that's just as deadly to her as anything else. No, she's deep down inside today. She's not wanting to come out and play at all. Generally speaking, as soon as you put it in there, if they are active and they are at the entrance to their burrow, she'll come and she'll push out the grass with her front feet, and she'll come out to the front where we can see her. But this particular spider on this particular day is dormant. She is resting at the bottom of her hole, probably digesting a big meal. Maybe she caught something big last night. She would have retreated to the end of her burrow, which is about this deep. She would have retreated right down to the bottom of her burrow with her prey, and she'd be eating it at the bottom of her burrow, meaning she wouldn't need to worry too much about a piece of grass at the entrance. She could also be on some eggs at the moment. Absolutely gravid. But generally, if they have got babies, those babies line the entrance to their burrows, and you can see all these little baby baboon spiders in the entrance. So we're going to leave her alone. Unfortunately, I couldn't show her to you today. And we're going to carry on with our wanderings over here, see if we can find you another one. All right, and while we carry on with our wanderings over here, I suppose, and see what other things we can uncover for you in this fantastic day, let me send you all the way over to Byron in Arethusa for an update.
And we're still exploring parts of Arethusa, Steph. We're having a good look around to see if we come across anything interesting. Nothing just yet. It's been fairly quiet here this morning, but it happens like that at times, and it's worth just having a look around and seeing what we can find on our travels. Very surprised we haven't seen more elephant. I really thought we would see some elephant on the side. Watch out. And again, there are just some really beautiful areas, beautiful views from here. Do have slightly high-lying crest areas, and just the view from up here is fantastic. If you might not be able to see it now, there are a few trees in front of us, but fairly shortly you might get a little opening, and I'm sure Jean-André will show you. Said he'll think about it. Kingfisher. Yeah, my brakes, I think, scare everything away. But there we go, it's a beautiful woodland kingfisher. Look at that. Even in the shade, the color is beautiful. It's hiding from us a little bit. There it goes. It's sitting just up there, I think. Oh, there are two of them. One just flew into... Let's see. Sorry. Just trying to look and see. The one flew into this marula off to our right. That's a bit tricky, genre. I wonder if that branch isn't in your way. I think it is. A little bit low down to the left. Yeah, it's in... Branches in the way. A bit tricky. The other one is still sitting just off to the right over here. Let's see if we can get... There we go. There's the other one still sitting in there. Very secretive little birds. Occasionally you get them sitting right out in the open, no problem, posing for you, and then at times they'll dart in into the trees and disappear very, very quickly. Lovely to see one though. Glad we got to see one. Oh dear. See a few starlings calling around us. The birds are quite active around here, but caught a starling flying over us. So birds are active, but as I said, not too much else. Not even impala. I haven't seen impala for quite some time, other than that one that alarm called at us earlier. As I said, that can happen out in the bush, as you all know. Doesn't mean you're not seeing anything, just means that animals are probably in another area. It gives you time to appreciate just being out here and spending time in the bush, having the peace and quiet that's around. Hope you all have a
okay, well, we've made it all the way down to the eastern edge of Juma. We were right in the west, and now we're heading north towards where I've heard there's Amber Eyes and three Birmingham boys. Oh, and now we got some kudu and some baboons. And warthog. Lots of different animals here. There's that baboon walking away. And the kudu. Hello, little one. Those massive ears. I do love kudu ears. Listening to every word I say. Oh, doesn't like what I'm saying. Just having a get a view of those warthog before we continue on towards three magnificent male lions. Where'd that pig go? There it is, it's not being... Oh, disappeared into the bush. Doesn't want to be on camera today, the warthog. Oh, they're running away. Okay, let's continue on towards the lions. Always check for tracks. Now, exciting. I don't think we've seen the three Birmingham boys together in a long time. Tenure was with Nkuma, so maybe he got left behind. Or maybe he's over here and we're missing either Nana or Tsoko. It'd be interesting to see which ones are here now. Oof, I think I'm going to struggle to tell the difference between Nana and Tsoko. I haven't seen them in so long. No one else has driven down Cheetah Cut Line yet. I think everyone's coming in from that side. We took the short way around, and on our way here, we actually found a leopard kill. Aubrey found it. He told us where to look. Now, it's a baby impala, but while they were tracking, that leopard ran south when they saw them and went down into Little Gowrie. So hopefully by this evening that leopard will come back. Now it doesn't look like Karula or the cubs. It was a male leopard, a young male leopard, so it could be Sindile, it could be a host of other male leopards that might have been moving into the area. So who knows, fingers crossed we might have a new male on the Sunset Safari. It looks like the sun is slowly winning its battle with the clouds. And I know a lot of you are just as excited as I am to see three big male lions together. Now, as I said, it sounds like there's a kill there. So there could be some fighting over the meat. Well, we'll have to see when we get there. So it should be just up ahead. Station with the Zingala at Quarry Found coming. Confirm best access is from Quarry Found itself. Thanks very much. I'm at Hippo Pools Junction with Cheetah Cut Line now. Okay, so we're a couple of minutes away. Sorry, Steenbokke! Whoa, off the Steenbokke goes. Okay. Okay, we're about maybe a minute 30 seconds, and we'll just see once we get there. Okay, so we're coming up towards Quarry Pan, and then we're just going to go on Hippo Pools for a little bit, and then north into the block. Apparently we can see the vehicles from the road, so it should be right here somewhere. So big Marula, I presume it's that one. Ah, there we go. I see them. Okay. I'm assuming it's Amber Eyes, I can't think it'd be anyone else. But now, instead of the attentions of one male, it looks like she's got the attentions of three. You've always got to be careful in driving around little round leaf teaks like this, because the elephants keep them so short that there could actually be a monster stump inside one of those tiny little bushes. Okay. Okay, we're about 20 seconds about from seeing what's going on. I can actually just make out the lions through the bush. I was just trying to look for the best route without the stumps. Now it's going to be interesting to see which of the male lions is lying closest to Amber Eyes. Is it still going to be the authority, or has his spot at the top had to be relinquished by one of the other males? Oh, there we go, there's Amber Eyes. And who is that next to her? Immediate growling. We're going to move now. It's a turnaround. Is it Mfumo? We can't see just yet. It is Mfumo. Mfumo is still holding his place at the top. And the other males must be beyond. Scent marking. I can just see the other two boys lying up in the distance. We will try to get a view of them now. Nice big bellies. Can't see where the carcass is just yet. He's trying to find a spot where he can lie between Amber Eyes and the other two males. Here we go. Shielding them, her from them. Okay, well, we're going to move around to try see a bit more. It's going to take a little bit of maneuvering. Let's have a look where we're going to go. Going to go behind the other vehicles. Oh, hello Dale, a brand new viewer. Welcome to the Safari Live family, Dale. Dale would like to know, how do we come up with the animals' names and what are they? Well, it all depends, Dale. Normally there's a process and a vote, and we try to choose the different names. And in doing that, we normally try use local Xitsonga or Shangaan names. And unless there's something very apparent that is not going to work for Xitsonga names. So for example, Amber Eyes has got she's the only lioness in the Nkuhuma Pride who's got orange eyes. Oh, there we go, let's just make some space here quickly and we can move through. And we don't normally name all the lionesses. The males, definitely we name them because they develop some really, really definitive characters and scars and wounds. And how's it? Thanks very much. Cheers. And the leopards as well. It's much easier to identify the individual leopards, and it's partly to keep track of them, partly because we see them so often. It'd be silly to call it that leopard with the two spots here and the one spot there. There's the kill. There's almost nothing left. It looks like a young buffalo. and just go have a look at which males are here. Next, eyes. Now, his name, or his name is Mfumo, the authority. And he is, seems to be bigger and more dominant than the other lions, the other male lions that are part of the Birmingham Coalition. There are four of them in total. Now, who do we have here? Is it the two missing, or is one of them Tino? Oh, I'm going to need some help here. I haven't seen the other two in so long. Could you be Tino with your balloon belly? Oh, this is going to be tough. Let's have a look at the other one there. That doesn't look like Tino. So that's either Nana, the warrior, or Tsugu, Goldie, or Gold. Oh, and the problem with our blonde or Goldie, who was referred to as Blondie quite a bit because he had a very blonde mane, is that as he got older, that obviously that mane's darkened, and it is quite a difficult one. That's, I'm pretty sure neither of these are Tino. So this is, oh no, one is Tino. He rolled over. It looked like Tino. Just zoom in on his face there for me, please. Is it? I can't see. It looks like it is Tino. Now, Tino means the tooth, because he's got a split lip and you can often see his canines through there. We can't really see clearly to make a definitive decision just yet. I'm trying to move around a little bit to see his face a bit better. So I'm going to look at the, trying to remember now, oh, he's up. No, we need to look at the other side of you. Where are you off to now? It looks like he might be smelling. Possibly amber eyes urinated there. Now, Tino was limping and very stiff yesterday. I think this is Tino. I need to see his left-hand side to be sure. More specifically, the left-hand side of his face. There we go. It is Tino. Can see that little scar there. Okay, so we've got Mfumo and Tino, and then I'm not sure who the third one is. Aaron says it looks like it could be Nena. He's got the equal signs on his nose. Okay, well, let's go have a look at Nena's face again. Now, the problem with that equals sign scar is that it wasn't a very deep one, so it's not like it's something that will last. I'm trying to remember if they had notches in their ears. Oh dear, this is going to be quite difficult, especially if I'm lying down like that. Anyway, you can definitely see that's Tino now. You can see the scar on his left lip. Okay, Okay, well, hopefully these lions get up and start feeding again shortly. While we wait for them to do that, let's go see what Steph's found on foot.
Also, I hope those lions get up and get active for you. I think it's going to be interesting to see today. All three male lions together. It's a Christmas present. We don't have something that exciting, but it is interesting nonetheless. We're sitting by a single elephant dropping. It's probably a bull elephant, judging from the size of it. But it is, and I'm talking about a good couple of pounds over here. Have a look at the spread of this. Now, for me, what's interesting about this particular pile of elephant dung is that it's been washed by the rain, but what it does is it gives us such a huge snapshot into why elephants are so important for the environment and why their droppings are so important. Elephants create open areas by knocking down trees and eating them. They don't have a very effective digestive system, and that is a good thing because they produce these massive amounts of dung all day, basically. Have a look. There's my hand for some scale, and just have a look at how big this actually is. It's just an enormous, and this is just a single bolus. The elephant will produce much, much more than this in a day. And it's made up mainly of wood. Now this was an elephant bolus that was dropped just before the dung beetles came out to play, otherwise they would have processed this and buried it. So this has been lying here for a few weeks. The rain has now washed it and is starting to disperse it. And all of this is just the most unbelievable compost. You can see how, although it is fairly dry on the outside, the inside is still wet from the rain and any moisture that it can absorb. Termites are starting to introduce sand. There's the termites. That's mud and clay and air into these boluses. There's a dung beetle hole there. There was one here. And this will now catch seeds, grass seeds, plant seeds from bird droppings coming to eat insects out of here, seeds rolling around, airborne seeds, it will catch it. And it just adds such a nice compost bed. And as the rain will start to disperse this, or people like me, we'll start to disperse this. You'll see it'll go over a wider and a wider area. Here's the original part of the bolus here. It's a little bit more tightly packed, this one. And what we were noticing here is, although in the dry season these elephants were eating almost all sticks and leaves, there's a branch, you don't really see a lot of thorns. I mean, I could probably step on this without worrying too much about the thorn. There's a fairly large stick that has been chewed through completely. Let's see if we can find a thorn. Set a challenge. This is a buffalo thorn. You can see that distinct zigzag, but no thorn. The thorns have been rubbed. I suppose it would make sense that they're thorns are rubbed blunt or rubbed to nothingness, otherwise they could puncture the intestines. So something else is happening inside an Ellie's tummy, not just the teeth. There's some more sticks. Still no thorns. And next time you have a view of some elephant with us, just have a careful look at how many thorns they do actually eat. But I can
sleep on it.
Yeah, VM says we could use it as a mattress. You could sleep on it. I think you'll have a soft bed, but it's gonna make you itch like crazy. I think it's all the creepy crawlies that are inside here. There's another stick. Also, no thorns. And very little insects in this particular bolus. We've seen some dung piles over here that literally, as soon as they fall on the ground, the dung beetles started it. So I think this was probably deposited before any major dung beetle activity started. And there's now fresher pickings, for lack of a better word, for them. So they're leaving this particular pile alone. There we're starting to see the ground. No, still digging through. Wow. This thing must have weighed, I don't know, 30 or 40 pounds when it came out. What do you think, Vio? It's massive. Here's another very well-chewed stick. Now, you can actually judge the relative age of an elephant that produced this bolus by having a look at precisely how fine the sticks are chewed. Very old elephant have gone through their sixth and final set of teeth, and they will start to masticate or chew finer and finer material. But when they do have to eat sticks and branches, which is in the dry season, they can't chew them as finely. And so you find whole sticks and whole leaves. One of the defining characteristics of a very old elephant dung is the fact that leaves will come out whole. And I suppose then thorns will come out whole as well. This particular elephant dung looks like from a very robust bull elephant. I'm judging it a bull by the size, the sheer volume of dung. And then also these sticks that we're finding over here have been chewed incredibly fine, except for that one, of course. But these, have a look at that. That's easily an inch wide, chewed up completely. There's a stick as well. Also, that's part of a much larger stick. This is our last stick. I'm going to show you proper branch being chewed up into tiny little pieces there. All right, now we're going to move on from our dung pile, and Byron's got some impala to show you.
And have a look, we're back finally, everyone. We're back on Juma, and we've just come across a wonderful, wonderful herd of impala with so many little lambs at the moment. This is really, really great. I'm going to move forward just very slowly. I'll try to show you. There's a few there. Look at that. I'm sure most of these, or quite a few of these, are fairly newborn. Perhaps during the course of the evening with that rain that we had. I'm hoping they don't move off too far. They seem pretty relaxed. And there they come. There we go. But there's a number of little young impala lambs around here. Look at that. Isn't that just a wonderful, wonderful sighting? The green grass in the background, these little lambs stumbling about. Oh, look, so cute. You can see already that one looks a little bit bigger than the other one that just moved off to the right. And it could be just a day or two, and it's incredible to see the size difference. Forrest, who's a new viewer, good morning to you, Forrest, and welcome. Great to have you on Safari Live with us. You wanted to know, do the impalas only give birth at one specific time during the year? And that is correct, Forrest, they do. But let me tell you what happens. So the rutting season for the impala, when the males are looking to mate with the females and they fight for dominance, is around April, May. And usually they mate in May. And then it's about a 6.5 month gestation period, and towards the beginning and middle of November is when the impala start lambing. That's the lambing season, and all of them try and give birth. All of them try and give birth around the same time, and the reason for that is so that they can keep. And keep a close eye on all these lambs and try and protect them all together. Also, what happens is it's basically not quite a defense mechanism, but a survival mechanism. So with all the lambs giving birth at the same, or being born at the same time, what happens is if predators hunt the lambs, because they are easy prey, and if predators hunt them, in a group like this, for example, we've got 10, 15 or 20 lambs, if 5 or 10 die or are caught by predators, there's still 10 or 15 that survive. So that's why the impala are so successful. And that is why we see so many of them in these areas. So that's generally the impala lambing season. However, there is a second rut, which occurs, if I'm not mistaken, I think it's around July, August, somewhere around there. And then that could cause a few late births around February, March, somewhere around there. You might see one or two lambs. It doesn't happen that often, but it does occur, and that's purely because females may not have been covered properly during the mating season, during the rut in April, May, and then there will be a second rut where the males try and cover those females that are not pregnant later on. But generally, it's one breeding season, and that's why we are seeing so many lambs around at the moment. Very, very nice sighting. That's lovely. Well, I'm glad we did get to see some animals moving around eventually. We were struggling a little bit this morning, but that's the way it goes. Especially when you go off exploring, you don't really know what you're going to find. Now, we're going to leave this impala and see what else we can find, but Brent is still with those beautiful male lions.
Well, as the link started, Amber I stood up, so we're just moving towards her. There we go. Is she trying to get back to the rest of the pride? And Fumo is keeping a very close tab on her. Oh, she's definitely had a good feed on that buffalo. They all have by the looks of things. What are you up to, madam? Are you just going to lie down again? Too hot to do anything. Flop. I thought she might move towards the carcass, but I don't think she can fit much more in her belly at the moment. Now, that other male lion is still a mystery. I'm not sure whether it's Nena or Tuku, but it's one of those things. I mean, I haven't seen them in so long. They could have got lots of new scars and nicks and whatnot, so we're going to have a closer look, but it's quite difficult when they're lying down. Oh, and look at this. That's just, we've got a little friend. There we go. Oh, I did used to know the name of this moth. Well, apparently, our final control have seen him. He's been with us for quite some time. He was even driving with us. Very pretty little moth, very hairy. I wonder if you are one of the moths that spawned the hairy caterpillars that attacked me. Naughty, naughty. Anyway, well, I'll leave him there. Now, the amazing thing is, we've been sitting here quite quietly. We're the only people with the lions at the moment. And we could hear another creature moving around the lions. I'll just see if I can get to a spot where we can see it nicely. Now, it's amazing. They've already, in 5 minutes, they've disappeared. Oh no, there's still some out, but as the sun's getting stronger and stronger, they are going to disappear. And I think it's that branch there. No? Yes, it is. No, is it? There we go. Look at them. We can actually hear the termites cutting up the dried wood and the dried leaves and taking them back down. Isn't that incredible? You can see the soldiers with their massive pincers standing guard. Now, these termites are not harvester termites. They look like Macromydes. my termites are a bit rusty. So you can see they are almost translucent. You can see straight through them. So they're actually in danger from the sun, and the sun will burn them. And that's why generally you only really see them at night or in the early morning out on the open, in the open foraging. And you can see the soldiers standing guard with those massive red heads on the edge of the workers' route in case any foul play happens, in case there's a bird or any other creature that decides to try eat them. Now, there's a lot less of them than there were earlier. Scuttle, scuttle, scuttle. And down they go. Oh, we've got some action behind us. Mfumo is up. See, it's not always about the massive lions. Even when we're next to massive lions, we spot the little creatures. Oh dear. That is probably the worst reason to go to a lion who's standing up. And the wind is blowing from him to us. Oh gee, wah. Oh my goodness, that smells horrible. Oh. No, we're moving. We're moving. We need to get out of the direct wind line. Wow. Fuff. That was quite impressive, Mfumo. Let's just try to get to a spot where we're not in that direct sort of breeze. Hi, a new witchy who's a brand new viewer, another new viewer. Great to have you on Safari Live. Sorry about that. I needed to get away from that. Oh, disgusting smell. Just see, is he moved again? What's he up to? Oh, he's gone back to sleep. New Richie is wondering about coalitions and how many lions are in a coalition or how many lions are in a pride. It's always in flux. So generally a very big pride in this area will be 10 adult females. Oh. 10 adult females. I've seen prides in this area with much more than that. But coalitions vary quite a lot as well. And he's just lying down next to Amber Eyes, making sure his body is positioned between her and the other males. So the Nkuma pride currently is 5 adult females and 6 cubs. Now, those cubs are around 6 months old, or just some of them a little bit younger, and they've still got a tough sort of 6-7 months ahead. Till they're about a year old, and there's always a very high mortality rate in lions, up to 50% in this part of the world. And so the pride numbers fluctuate constantly, and so do coalition numbers. Now, the Birmingham boys were originally 5 male lions. One unfortunately got killed by a wound suffered in a buffalo hunt. He got a lung punctured by a buffalo horn. But here we go. So the Birmingham boys, and generally once they're established in an area, it's unusual for a coalition member to die as early as that one did. Normally they'll be established for 4 or 5 years, and coalitions can range from 2 to the biggest I've heard of, 8. So it all depends. And quite often, they're not always related males, and they're not always of the same age. But by forming a coalition, they are able to dominate a larger area. So the Birmingham boys, for example, are lord over 3 different prides. The Nkuhuma pride, who we've seen this morning, and this lioness here is part of the Nkuhuma pride. The Styx pride, who we see from time to time, and the Torchwood pride, who we've actually never seen on live drives. So there we go, that's who the 3 prides that we know about the Birmingham's being in charge of. But I'm pretty sure they're all going to be here on the Sunset Safari. So lions everywhere. And hopefully we'll find out who that young male leopard, or that male leopard that ran away from Aubrey on foot, is if he returns to retrieve his impala carcass. So we're going to leave these lions, head to find ourselves some breakfast. Hopefully it smells a bit better than what's deposited behind us. But we will see you in a few short hours for the Sunset Safari. And it's Gert's last drive, so we're going to say goodbye to him. I'm sure he'll be back again at some point. There we go, big nod. Oh, a very pretty, pretty daylight moth. Oh, has landed and taken off in a matter of seconds. It was a little burnet. A forester moth. Well, I'm sure we're going to see a few more of those. But for the last few minutes, let's go back across to Byron.
Brent's had a lot of luck with the lions this morning. That's fantastic, and I do think they will still be around this afternoon, so hopefully we'll get to see them. And like Brent says, maybe a leopard too. That would be great. It's been an interesting morning for us exploring around, and some squirrels. Let's see if we can get that little squirrel quickly. There it is. Oh dear. Little tree squirrel just running off very, very quickly. Nice to see those elephants early on this morning. I'm very glad that we did get to see them. But we'll hopefully try for some more creatures this afternoon, more animals, and we'll see what we can do. But from myself and from Jandre on camera with me this morning, thank you very much. Hope you've all enjoyed it. Let's head over to Steph and he can say goodbye.
I heard such an interesting story about this grass. Let me just pick this grass. This is a piece of carrot seed grass. And I was told that this grass is the inspiration for Velcro. The person who invented Velcro was looking at this grass, looking at the way that it stuck to your socks, and decided to come up with a concept of Velcro from this grass. How true that is, I'm not too sure, although these are very sticky seeds and they do have a very Velcro-y type look to those hooked spines that each grass seed has. And of course they're designed to hook into fur and to be transported from one place to another, where they basically just stick to everything, every piece of your sock. They get into your shoes and they create blisters. One of the reasons why I wear these coverings on my shoes is for these types of seeds. They are just at that angle that they would bash against your sock and go into your shoe, as those three seeds have just fallen in there now. You take them out before they do cause an issue, and that's why I wear these coverings, to keep the grass seeds out. And I've got a thorn net. So you pick up all these passengers while you're walking around here in the bush. Thorn embedded in my leg. One of those things, you know. It's just been such an epic day today. We've had lion, those three male lions lying together, and Kahuma Pride back on track again. There's just tracks everywhere, and it rained last night. Probably didn't do too much. We're looking at some pans and some puddles that we have around the place where we've been walking today, and they've all been pretty shallow. I mean, this depression, for instance, is holding no water whatsoever. And it should hold a little bit of water after rain like we had yesterday. At the moment, it's just got some mud in it. I don't think we had more than 5 millimeters of rain yesterday at all, which is actually okay, to be honest. Now, David, you just said, why did I say we have to avoid puddles of water? I can't remember saying that, David. I think we need to see puddles of water. I don't think that we need to avoid them at all. In actual fact, when you're driving, quite the opposite. It's quite often the best thing to drive through puddles. You don't make these wide roads around puddles, but you've got to do it slowly, because quite often the puddles out here are home to a bunch of different frogs and terrapins and beetles, and they need to get out of the way of the cars, really. Walking through puddles, you could do that, but you know, wet socks and wet shoes, they're not my favorite thing. They won't give you any more blisters or any less blisters unless you've got sand in. But and it's always the best thing to try and keep socks and that dry when you walk out here. But yeah, now you don't have to avoid puddles, David. You can walk through and jump in as many puddles as you like. Let's go and have a look at this marula tree. Well, we're coming to the end of the show, so your look at this marula tree is probably just going to be at looking at how big it is. But from our side, from myself and VM and from the rest of the crew, and Brent, who was out this morning along with Khat and Jandre and all the FC ladies, we just want to say thank you very, very much for all your support. Remember to keep on watching. We'll see you this afternoon. Wherever you are in the world, have a good day.